So many people today think our food system is broken, and there are a lot of reasons they think that. Agriculture has a huge impact on the environment. 40% of all the land on Earth is devoted to agriculture, 70% of fresh water goes to agriculture, almost a third of climate emissions come from agriculture. So that feels like a broken food system. 800 million people going to bed hungry. On the other hand, if we think about how far we've come, you come to a very different conclusion. And so today, 800 million people are going to bed hungry, but 30 years ago, 20% of all the people on the planet were going to bed hungry, and 60 years ago, 30% of all the people on the planet were going to bed hungry. So 10% is a terrible number. We need to do better, but it's wildly better than it was in the past. And the same thing is true if we look at global rates of childhood mortality, the lowest point in all of human history. And so the question is, you know, is our food system broken? Well, when was it not broken? When was it better than it is today? And the answer is, it never was. I think there is sometimes misinformation that's out there, but I think too often we're really just focusing on the present. So we're looking at the real problems in terms of land and water and deforestation, and those are things that are all true. The problem is that population is growing. And so it becomes harder and harder for agriculture to keep up. And so what we should recognize that in many ways, things are not bad and getting worse. They're good and getting better, but not fast enough. And so that means accelerating the pace of improvement instead of blaming farmers for not doing even more. So I think there are two things that could accelerate the pace of improvement. One is the government policy and investment could increase. You know, with more money and more resources, we could accelerate the pace of innovation so we could get to our 2070 goals by 2050, our 2050 goals by 2030. But the second piece relates to the consumer, because science tells us what we can do and the public tells us what we should do. So we need to ensure that the public not only supports innovation, but demands these innovations. And that requires the consumer to really understand the role of innovation in our society. And too often today, people are passionate about food, but they don't really understand food production because we're so far removed from the farms that our parents or our grandparents may have grown up on. And so we need to do a better job of engaging with them so the things that they demand will actually deliver the benefits that they want. Before I joined the university, I was working with the Nature Conservancy. And conservation organizations are very good at telling farmers what they should do, instead of talking to them about what they could do. Could is about opportunity, and people enjoy that, but nobody likes to be told what to do. So we need to change the nature of that conversation in order to bring people together in order to solve the problems. Because all of the problems are big, and they can't be solved in isolation. So most people, when they think about the future, they ask two questions. What do I think will happen, and what should I do about it? Now, that's a very natural way of thinking about the future, and it makes a lot of sense. This is how most businesses approach it. This is how most governments approach it. This is really strategic planning. The problem is that we're all preparing for a future that we don't really want. You know, we think about what's the most likely thing to happen, and then what can I do to prepare for it? But that will only take us to the place we expect to go. And nobody expects that the likely future is the best future. Instead, if you have a strategic foresight approach, you think like a futurist. Well, now all of a sudden you're asking the question, where do I want to go? And the place you want to go is a better place than the place you expect to go. And so what we need to be doing is the things we do tomorrow need to be preparing us for our best future instead of preparing us for a future that we don't want to go to. And so it leads to very different choices in our lives. And those choices can lead us to a much better place. So when most people think about the future, they sort of stop thinking about it in 2050. So we're gonna have 9.5 billion people, and they kind of expect that everything's gonna get harder and everything's gonna get worse year after year after that. But the reality is that population growth slows dramatically in 2050, and that's because we're not having more children. The number of children born next year will be less than this year, and less the year after that, and the year after that. 100% of population growth is because of people living longer. It's a good news story about health and nutrition, but we're just not gonna live forever. And so the challenge we have is not to produce more and more food forever, it's to get to 2050 without cutting down our forest and without draining our rivers, our lakes, and our aquifers. Because if we do, in many ways, we're good forever. because after population growth slows, it just becomes easier. So every day between now and 2050, it gets harder to feed the world. But every day after 2050, it will get easier to feed the world if we haven't screwed things up. And so the point I'd like to make is that the next 25 years, they're not just the most important 25 years there have ever been in the 10,000 year history of agriculture, and they are. They're the most important 25 years there will ever be in the history of agriculture. And that's why we need to get it right. But if we do, we're good forever. So I think there are a lot of ways that organizations like EECA can help. One is that they're trusted by farm organizations and governments. And so the kinds of innovations that they help to develop will be more easily disseminated. The second way, though, is that they can help to share information across the region so that we can accelerate the pace of innovation, because they're talking and working with different organizations. But they're also working with governments, and they have an opportunity to change the nature of the conversation, because they see what's happening on the ground and they see what's happening in different places, and they can help us to move quicker by making the changes that need to happen, because we don't have a lot of time. We have one generation to achieve our goals. So I recently received the Borlaug Award for Science Communication, and for me, it's very important because it raises the profile of the importance of communication. It brings attention to the fact that it's not enough that we do the science, we need to be able to communicate the science so that people understand it, appreciate it, and are willing to adopt these new innovations. So it gives me the opportunity to speak to more audiences and to share the message of the benefits of innovation.